I'm just exhausted. I want to get some air.
That's the best way to start a podcast, by the way.
Yeah. Now we just recorded that too.
I know. I saw. I got in. It's good. Yeah. We're both kind of tired. I just got in, and
did you just get in?
Yeah. Like I had enough time to like eat broccoli and like an orange. Oh, no. Like the dirty bad meal.
Broccoli and orange.
I was like, all right, cool.
Well, I had some. I saw on my doorbell cam, some kid left like a package at the front door. So I was like, oh, I'll go grab it. So I went out to look for it. I guess like 2 hours later, it's gone because it's so windy and so cold. Oh. So I'm like, so I'm like freezing out there.
Wait, the package is gone or the kid is gone because it got blown away?
The kid, I saw the kid leave on the camera. So we didn't lose him. That's not my responsibility. Yeah. Package gone. It's like one of those little thin ones. I don't know where it went.
Oh, okay.
Maybe I'll find it in the morning.
Probably not. It's gone.
No, it's gonna be like minus 18 tomorrow. It's stupid. It's so cold.
Right it's literally like a whole new Toronto out there. Like yeah. It wasn't like this last week.
No, just for the weekend, and then it's gone.
I mean, it's almost like someone rebooted our entire universe.
Pricks.
Back at it again, like we never the pricks. Coke and dick, leave it all in. We are DeLethal Weapons.
Hey, Dank.
Hey, Coke.
Why do dogs float in water?
Why do dogs float in water?
Because they are good boys. Boys.
Should have just called everybody pricks.
They are.
I would laugh. I would. It's still good. Pricks. I laugh. No, I like irate Coke. It works for me.
And I said that because there's a lot of good.
Really? There's so many different ways. There's so many other things you could have said instead of that. I don't. Do you want a redo? No, I'll give you a redo
I'm
for
trying
that.
I'm trying to get through this.
But like, put out quality.
Good boys.
I'd love if anybody's out there listening and you think Coke had a good one-liner, you tell us that was a good one-liner.
You're the one cutting this, so.
I am. Oh, I'm leaving that in.
So then you want to have me redo it?
It's terrible. Send your replies at comic_patrol at Twitter. If not, you can hit us up at our comicpatrolspod@gmail.com.
I told my wife she drew her eyebrows too high. She seems surprised.
That's good. Yeah, that's good. This is good boys. You didn't sell the boys.
I'm so tired.
But explain how boying is about, like, I guess the new, another new reboot. Yes. Like, this is the second incarnation of, like, the DC. We keep calling it FU. Fractured Universe, but again.
The DC FU?
I don't even know if it's that anymore.
I don't know what it is, but it's. They've got.
I think it's DC. Yeah.
Listen, we're both getting what we asked for with this, so it's hard to be too mad about it.
I mean,
what? Go on.
I can get angry at certain things,
such as that is another reboot.
Yes, we finally did a 180 on Baffleck. Like, we actually want him back now, and now like we're not getting him. Henry Cavill was a decent Superman.
Yeah, that's,
we didn't really get to see him shine.
That's a shame that he's not coming back. But.
Gal Gadot, arguably the best casted in their original, I guess, original Justice League. Mm-hmm. And she's, I mean, after the monstrosity of 1984, but she was the best thing.
But we don't know if she might be back. We don't know that yet. They haven't confirmed that yet.
Well, she's definitely going to make an appearance in Shazam Fury of the Gods. Mm-hmm. So, huh.
So the interesting there with that is that, so one of the co-CEOs, we heard from James Gunn, a co-CEO, along with, why did you put your...
Oh, my bad. I had to... I had to see the other half of my screen, the way that my setup
it's
is.
Okay, I see you're sitting in your undies.
But then I realized, yeah, I'm actually happy at home. So yeah, no pants. I'm not wearing pants. Yeah, I'm not wearing pants. So, yeah. That's a better setup,
Joe. That was amazing. Than, yeah. I was like, what's he doing? And then you just left it there, right in your crotch. And I was like, wait a second.
Yeah, well. I got to give somebody the money shot, right? So.
Okay. Yeah, that was good. And it wasn't even on purpose. That's the best part. Okay. Like I was saying, we heard from one of the co-CEOs.
If it was on purpose, I'd be wearing no draws.
Right. That's what I'd see your dinky.
I call it Tinky, first of all.
Tinky Winky. So the co-CEOs being Peter Safran and James Gunn. One James Gunn. We're late to this party because I'm sure you've heard about it already, but we're going to give our thoughts anyways.
I think we're on time. It takes about like a day and a half for everyone to be like, all right, let everything settle. And now here's the good shit.
Yeah, here's the good stuff.
There's a lot of good shit.
So they're keeping the originally planned movies. The Batman, Joker 2, Shazam 2, The Flash, Blue Beetle, Aquaman 2. They're all going to be like Elseworld stories, right? So those are all still coming out, but they're not going to be part of this new rollout. It's called Chapter 1, Gods and Monsters. They also named themselves the DCU. So back when like Snyder and stuff were in control, they refused to name their universe anything. So people, fans just named it the DCEU, right? But they never...
That and they started calling it the Snyderverse.
The Snyder,
right?
Yeah. Like, so now they're kind of like, no, you know what? We're going to go full Marvel. The big difference here... And James Gunn said it too, is kind of like, yeah, we're doing the Marvel thing, but we're more organized than Marvel was at the beginning. Because they just kind of, their phase one was kind of like, we'll just put some heroes and then we'll kind of tie them together as they went, right? Because they didn't figure out they were going to do that until after Iron Man 1.
But,
and where it's going with these 10 dropping. Some of them really cool, some of them, for me personally. But it's,
and then some like a lot of unknowns, yeah. Too, right? Like, yeah,
left field stuff.
Especially with Gunn, it gives a chance for fresh eyes and kind of a fresh perspective. You said we weren't going to talk about Marvel, but we know James Gunn from his Guardians of the Galaxy pedestal. He put his vision on that, and arguably they're the best things to come out of the MCU in the last, what are we at now, 13 years? 12 years?
Yeah.
We're up there.
Maybe 2008, so 18, maybe 15 years.
Jeez.
Wow.
We've been watching
15 years?
Good Lord.
It would
that
be
doesn't
though.
Make
it
sense.
Would be though. 2018, 19, yeah. This will be. So it's been 14 years, but this will be its 15th year, which is wild. So they're 15 years ahead of DC right now.
Like they raised a teenager.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Damn, that's crazy, man.
It makes sense to why they're so awkward right now.
Yeah, I think because they're in that weird kind of
puberty age. Yeah,
trying to find their identity again.
I was gonna make a whole bunch of erection jokes, but. Decided not to.
Like,
already flashed.
Like when you like when the teacher tells you to draw the chalkboard, you're like, nah.
Not thinking about getting.
Because I just this thing happened, and I you know. So this is all set to start in 2025. So we got a couple of years before it all kind of kicks off. One thing that was kind of cool was when you would listen to the James Gunn promo, right? And he did some interviews about it too, and he even mentioned. Right. You know, what's different is, yes, we're planned from the beginning. And also, I think they asked him about superhero fatigue. And he goes, yeah, I think it's real. So that means you can't really tell the same story, which is like good guy, bad guy, giant thing mm-hmm. in the sky. He didn't say blue beam, but blue laser beam, but he meant
yeah,
it, right?
Yeah, we knew.
He's like, you guys start dealing with some more complex issues and characters and respect the audience to understand that superhero films aren't just that. So that's a good way to start it. And I believe him because his characters are usually pretty nuanced and at least the superhero versions of them, like Guardians of the Galaxy, Suicide Squad, things like that, right?
right? Peacemaker.
Yeah, Peacemaker, yeah.
And this is coming out from kind of the pushback from the majority of Hollywood is just like another superhero story. So you get that all these creators on one side, we'll look at DC specifically, are trying to let the public and kind of their peers know that we're not just telling superhero stories. There's more multifaceted things that are going on. And the way that we're going to give it to you, you're going to get to start to see these stories that maybe they need a new name for superhero films, right? Mm-hmm. Like
DCEU films. But what is the lineup? It's 5 shows and 5 movies. We already talked about the ones that we just mentioned, the ones that are still coming out. We don't need to talk about them. But
although I'm super excited for Blue Beetle.
Blue Beetle's gonna be cool, yeah. Yeah, that'd be cool. I can't think the Flash is still going forward. I think they're still going with Ezra Miller, right? Like that's
you have to. That's the best one because like it's a clusterfuck and at the end you could probably kill him and just bring in another Barry. Like that's the one where the after credit teaser is probably gonna let you know this is the Guns universe coming out of the previous universe. So that's the one I expect them to just be inserting scenes, and if it doesn't make sense, it doesn't have to. It's kind of
awesome. Michael Keaton confirmed for that one? He was, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So that could be interesting. That could be interesting. We'll see. We'll see.
I hope Batgirl's confirmed for that one, right? Like that's still on the show.
No, they got rid of it. They nixed it.
That's completed, though.
I know, that's almost there. Yeah, but they just nixed it.
Like, come on,
it's crazy. Man. It must have been that bad.
I don't think so.
Well, why don't you just release it on HBO Max?
That's what I'm saying. Have you seen some of the schlock that DC has churned out in the last? Yeah. Has it been 15 years? Even longer. DC's been around longer in several incarnations.
Superman 1 was the first superhero movie, really, brought from comics to film.
Fair enough.
One, was it 78?
Even it that, yeah. Somewhere. Christopher Reeve. Yeah,
that was the first one, live action.
But here's the new run.
Here's a new run. I'm going to do it in the order that James Gunn presented it. I'm not doing like the shows, the movies, because there's 5 of each. But the way he presented it was number one was Creature Commandos, which I've never heard of before. I was like, all right. Dope. There's a couple ones here. I was like, I have no idea about these. That's dope. But it's a team with Rick Flag. This is gonna be a show, an animated show. So it's gonna have Rick Flag Senior, which is the father of the Rick Flag we know. Nina Mazurs.
I like that you had this.
I just wanted to make sure it was Senior. So yeah. The four people listening to us were like, what? Joel Kinnaman? No, it's not. It's the senior, Nina Mazursky, Dr. Phosphorus, Eric Frankenstein, G.I. Robot, and Weasel. And they'll all be led by the Bride of Frankenstein.
It's awesome that Weasel's still there. Gets to
come
back.
I guess he's like immortal. He just keeps living.
He's the survivor. Like, that's amazing. And he already got his like prequel.
Yeah. So yeah. I'm all in for that. Yeah, I don't know if this is going to be like a past thing. Because I think they started in World War II.
Oh, shit.
Sure. From the comics. I believe it's these guys.
Oh, yeah, especially if we're talking about Rick Flag Sr.
Yeah, I believe it's these guys.
But this is kind of like their own dark universe, the shit that we never ended up getting, where they were trying to build Dracula, the Mummy, Bride of Frankenstein. So kudos, because I'll take it. We had a show, and I was all excited about all these celebs that were going to play these big monster badasses. So who knows? Who knows what the casting is going to look like? It'd be amazing if you got some nods from that original iteration of what they thought they were trying to build with the, what did they call it? The monster universe, the dark universe.
Yeah, it was something like that. Dark universe. Who was the? Was that Fox doing that?
I'm gonna say yeah.
Yeah, because it wouldn't have been WB, right? Well, because WB owns DC, but this is the power of Discovery. So once they got bought by Discovery, I guess Discovery was like, listen, we're gonna do it the Marvel way. We're just gonna do it better. So. Let's get James Gunn in here because everybody loves him and he's amazing at what he does. And so we're rolling with it, right? Anyways, Creature Commandos, I don't know. It's going to be an animated show. So this is kind of like the prequel. This is what's going to get us. It's going to get us wet. Amanda Waller will be in it and it will actually lead into her own show, which will be live action with Viola Davis.
Yes.
So after putting the Commandos together, she gets her own show that will involve Team Peacemaker. So that. Now that's required watching, right? I still haven't watched it, so I didn't jump on that. But
first of all, that's amazing watching. Yeah, so I will. The fact that Gunn has already connected Peacemaker, Suicide Squad, Waller from original Suicide Squad into a thread that kind of makes sense is amazing. But I just wanted to give kudos to Viola Davis, who was one of the best things about the previous universe in DC. Her Waller depiction was good.
She's terrific, and well, she's amazing. So I'm really glad that they're giving her the Nick Fury, the Samuel Jackson Nick Fury kind of work here, which is dope. Just throw her into everything, and she'll be the connective tissue for, it seems like, a lot of these things, at least for the team up things. Because the Creature Commandos is the same sort of thing. She's a special force she puts together. She doesn't care if they die. So it's basically like the Suicide Squad version 2, or version 1, right? Because it's before the Suicide Squad even happened. Maybe it's her first hurrah at this. Her first time ever just putting a bunch of weirdos together and letting them do their thing.
Yeah. And maybe like her origin of like why she became so cold and just decided that like heroes and metahumans could be expendable. Because I mean, I don't think she was born that way, right?
No.
Some sort of catalyst. But excited.
Yeah. And this show will be, it'll have a lot of, they haven't told us much about everything yet, but this show is supposed to be pretty crazy. A lot of entertaining twists and turns, and with Viola Davis in the driver's seat, you know, and Team Peacemaker, like you're saying. So
again, you were bringing up Peacemaker before. I already expect twists and turns from watching that show. Great show, amazing casting, really smart kind of arc. You'll enjoy it. Yeah, I think when you inevitably get to it.
Ready to go. I just haven't had the time.
And the only weird thing was kind of tonally Peacemaker changes from Suicide Squad to his own show, but there's like one line of dialogue to be like, okay.
But it takes place before the Suicide Squad movie, right? It takes place after?
Yeah, you remember Suicide Squad, the movie, credits show him in the hospital, right? So.
Oh, I thought it was a prequel. Interesting. Didn't even know that.
John Cena. So you can expect to see him.
So that'll be a live action show.
If you can see him.
Twisting off of an animated show. I can't see him. I can't. And that'll take us to the one announcement here that actually has a date. For July 11th, 2025, Superman Legacy. Which will be written by James Gunn himself. And it'll follow Kal-El as he bridges the gap between his alien and earthly ties, which sounds an awful lot like Man of Steel. So this is basically a reboot of Man of Steel.
Yeah, this is the fourth incarnation of Superman on the big screen, if I'm correct.
Yeah. Is it fourth?
I'm not talking TV. Yeah, because we had a Christopher Reeves, then Brandon Routh.
Oh, that's right. That's the one with Gene Simmons, right? Or not Gene Simmons, Gene Hackman. God. Wrong Gene. Gene Hackman.
Gene Hackman in the original. He's the original? He's Lex Luthor.
We don't talk about who's in the Brandon Routh one. Then. We don't.
No, we can still bring up Kevin Spacey's name. That dude's embedded in Hollywood.
Yeah, I know. I
mean, in just amazing films.
Usual Suspects?
Seven? Come on, there's a whole bunch of
Even House of Cards was amazing. Amazing
Until
show.
It wasn't Until amazing. It wasn't amazing,
yeah. Anyways,
I was gonna say American Beauty, where he won an award for that. And that movie's so good but twisted.
It's almost a shame he's like, well, it's a never mind. I won't get into it. Go ahead.
That's another podcast. Yeah. And then we moved to Henry Cavill, which again I thought was a really good pick. But his Lex Luthor was Eisenberg. Jesse.
Yeah, that was a weird choice. They've made some weird, even, I remember the animated ones where they had Rainn Wilson playing it for a long time. I was like, guys, what are you doing? What's the guy's name who did the last, we were talking about it.
DJ Beta.
Beta, there we go.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
The only reference I like using him for is from the Drew Carey show, he played Oswald. But he's got such a deep, tone of voice that he understood the smarminess. So again, I mean, if you want to shave his head, I'm all for you casting the actual actor. Mm-hmm. With Legacy, you don't know what age they're going to kind of pick up Kal-El from, right? Like, you don't know if you want this actor to grow into inevitably being Superman, or if he's already established, or if he's more of like the Connor Kent,
yeah,
like Superboy age. So there's a lot on that plate. The fact that he put a date down and he's writing this. Gunn's like writing a lot of stuff. So I'm hoping his team is ready for the assignment. But if not, you can just plagiarize, right? It's just comic book.
Yeah, he's gonna have his fingerprints all over everything coming up. So it's sayonara for his Marvel career, I'm assuming, his MCU career, because he's gonna be very busy here. They made him CEO, co-CEO, to make sure that he wasn't bouncing back and forth, I think. It was kind of like, no, you're ours now. And
well, why not? Like, he was, like, maybe the ace in the hole that
he changed
was kind of underappreciated by Marvel, too, right? Like, they were ready to fire him and boot him out if his cast didn't say, like, yo, this is our guy. What are you doing?
And we mentioned it before. He's shaped the MCU into what it is now. Like, the turning point for the MCU was the first Guardians of the Galaxy movie. That's kind of like, all right, let's bring in some weird team that no one's ever heard of, and we'll make them lovable. And that's exactly what they did. And now that's kind of the blueprint for movies going forward. The problem is they've copied it so many times that it's too easy now. So he's got to reinvent the wheel, like, for DC now. So, which I'm all the confidence in the world he will. So.
Yeah, and then with movies like Brightburn, you kind of wonder with something like Superman, how dark are you going to go? Like, where's the moral line? Like, are you going to make him?
Actually, I'm glad you said that, because he did say that as far as tonally, the movies will have a similar tone, except for one that we'll get to when we get to it. But he did mention that the works that they are inspired by, it won't be adaptations of books, right? So Superman Legacy, he said, is inspired by All-Star Superman. But it will not be that exact story. It'll just kind of be that tone. It's going to borrow that tone, right? Yeah. So, and we'll go down the list, like the other ones coming up. It's going to be inspired by this. The tone will be a little bit more, it'll be a little lighter. It won't be all like Dark World Snyderverse stuff, which had its place in certain films, but not for
not for everything, right. And that was the problem that happened with Superman. Yes. He got dropped into this grim, bleak Gotham like life, and we're like, this is not you. So, as much as I'm not a Superman fan, but am kind of a Superman fan based on all the stuff we've done, I really hope they kind of give him back his Boy Scout champion of like America and chin up to the sky, his goody two shoes kind of thing. Christopher Reeves, like that emblem that he could do no wrong, was really good and kind of emblematic of how you read Superman. He's supposed to kind of be the one that has no flaw, that they had to invent flaws for him. So I'm hoping they can kind of replicate that.
Superman, I know this is kind of a broad statement, but Superman is as good as the writer who carries that torch. Because it's interesting, like you were saying, I never used to like him until we started doing this podcast. And the more we do it, the more I actually appreciate well-written Superman stories, because they're hard to do. Right. They're very hard to do.
Yeah, they're very hard.
But when you nail it, it's like, oh, like Alan Moore did a really good job. Some of the anime movies we did, like, was it Mark Miller who did the Superman Red Sun? We didn't read the book. Watch movie. Like, there's some good things there that they take his core values and they twist his own head. This movie here, the Superman Legacy, I'm really getting Superman Man of Tomorrow type vibes. Okay. That's kind of what it won't be the same story beat, but that's kind of the vibe I'm getting. You know, he's kind of, he's younger-ish. He's new on this. He's new on the town and stuff. Things like that, right? Because the reason why they didn't want to stick with Henry Cavill is because they wanted to go with someone younger.
Which is unfortunate.
Which sucks, but it's James Gunn vision, right?
Listen, I'd love to see Henry Cavill cast as Bizarro Man. Bizarro Superman. Yeah. We're not there yet, but
that'd be a cool throwback. Well, and like you said, there's we talked about before, there's Elseworld stories, there's gonna be multiverse type of things going on, and at some point they're all gonna, you know, come crashing together at some point. You can have an Elseworld Superman as Henry Cavill. You could do Red Sun with Henry Cavill. You could easily do that. You give him, he can't do a Russian accent. I'm sure that guy could.
The one movie where he got to play English against someone who was playing Russian was The Man from U.N.C.L.E., and the guy who was playing Russian against was Armie Hammer, who at one point was tipped to be the next Bruce Wayne, but Armie Hammer is Armie. I guess this is the podcast where we just find all the all the weird kind of celeb actors out there. But at one point, that was going to be the, like, you had the Batman and the Superman. You had the Bruce and you had the Clark. So I say that to say I'm sure Henry can do anything you put in front of him. I just think the guy got a raw deal, and he was one of he was one of the bright stars of that iteration.
That's what I was just gonna say. It's kind of too bad. You kind of want him to get one really, because he's a good Superman. So you want to kind of get him that one really good movie, because Man of Steel's acceptable, but it ain't it. You know, it's anyways. So we'll move on to the next thing, which will be a live action show. This one I'm really, really excited about. This is one of the ones I'm really into. Lantern.
Yes.
Focusing on Hal and John, but not only those two. Apparently, he's going to have some other lanterns in there.
Yeah, you know Guy Gardner's going to get slapped. You know Guy Gardner's going to get slapped. You know it.
So they're going to be in there, and as they do their little space police thing, and he said it's going to be reminiscent of True Detective.
Yeah, that was a an insane nod, and I don't know if that was smart to reveal as early as you did, but fans of True Detective are definitely like, yo, like, I know what that is. So are you sure you're going this dark with, like, space?
Don't play with me, yeah, because that first season of True Detective is incredible TV.
And then it falls off again. But that third season of True Detective is some incredible TV.
I heard it's like, I heard it's worth going back for. Because I know the second one, I watched like a few of the second one. I was like, this dips, I can't. Yeah.
Certain things don't.
That third one I've heard is it
Mahershala.
Mahershala Ali, yes.
And Stephen Dorn, which is a funny nod because now he's the new Blade, and Dorn played the first villain in Blade against Wesley Snipes. So,
oh, that's right. Yeah, yeah. Interesting.
There's fun little nods going all around there. Oh,
but that's really cool, man. And it's going to be taking place in space.
Yes.
You know, so I hope it's not like an origin, like, this is how we get the ring.
I don't think so.
We already have it.
And he definitely said that this series would help be a larger arc to everything that's going on in his universe. So whatever crime that they're trying to solve may have kind of ramifications to everything that's going on, which is a lot of world building. So for geeks like us, that sounds insane, but that's a lot to, like, take on for a reboot.
And what's cool about this is that there is no real, there's no Green Lantern in the DCEU. They just have that one Green Lantern movie that neither one of us has ever seen. But it's also uncharted territory from, we're going to make comparisons. I'm sorry to bring it up again, but it's uncharted territory for MCU because they have never done a Nova movie. Yeah. And they did a Nova Corps movie. Oh. Nova Corps has been there, but they got wiped out by Thanos. So there's no space police. Oh. So this is a whole new thing. I'm really looking forward to this.
And it kind of makes me wonder if they're going to go back to the dream casting that they had initially, right? John Stewart was always tasked to be Common at one point.
Oh, really?
And that was supposed to happen. And then Hal Jordan before Ryan Reynolds was supposed to be, God damn, what's his name?
Do you remember?
I do know. Bradley Cooper.
Bro, Bradley Cooper. Oh, Rocket. Hey, he could. That could happen. Yeah. That'd be cool. And it's cool that it's the two of them together. So it's not just going to be, you know, here's Hal. Yeah. And then down the line is, no, we're bringing it. And then, like you said, Guy Gardner, maybe Kyle Radner, maybe. Like, that'd be sick, man. That'd be really cool.
It's always weird that, like, really Earth has like 4 to 7 legends. When basically all is like, no, one ring in one sector of the universe. But Earth is just so fucked up that you need, like,
can Jessica Cruz too? It's like, let's get them all.
That would be amazing, by the way, if you led with her somehow.
I really, really, especially if you got Dan Guerrero back. Ooh. Because that's one thing I'll say. We'll save it for the end. Okay, next up is The Authority, which, get kind of excited for this, is a Wildstorm imprint from 1999. This will be the first imprint of Wildstorm to ever hit the silver screen.
And this is why you got to love James That's Gunn. Sick. He's one of those guys that looks on the shelf and is like, who haven't we been using?
Yeah.
This is similar to kind of, if you've heard our Alan Moore rant, one of those writers, you saw the landscape and saw who everyone was writing and was like, but there's so much more. And like, let me try a vigilante. Let's see what goes on there. Let me try let me try a swamp thing and pull that off the shelf. Gunn seems to have that same approach of like, yes, we'll handle the big ones that we need to handle, but there's so much out there that just let's see what we can do with it. And the Authority is going to be one of those ones.
Yeah. It's going to be cool. Cause it's about a team, that will do anything in their power to change the world, no matter what. So it's almost like a, it's almost like a team of peacemakers. Do you know what I mean? Like, so they're just like, no, we're gonna do what we need to do, and that's all there is to it. Now, interesting enough, some past members of the Authority, the Midnighter, a lot of people I don't know, but there's the Midnighters in it, who's in DC now. Grifter was a part of it. So if you're looking for connections
to Wildcats.
Wildcats, that'd be...
That's huge.
Wildstorm Imprint, man. Bring it on. That'd be dope.
And again, just opens the door to Wildcats, right? And they've been talking about that for so long, trying to get Grifter down, right? He's always been kind of that Gambit elusive.
He's like... Yeah, he's like their Gambit meets Wolverine. Yeah. He does his... Like, it's a... And he's that lovable badass, right? That everybody loves. It's like, oh, it's just some guy with guns.
Super interested on what the costume's going to look like, because he's always had that like loose leaf mask. Fanny. Yeah, like the bandana. Mm-hmm. Right? Cool. Very cool.
So that's interesting. Like I said, it's hard to talk about, but it's fun to talk about, because they didn't really give us much. They just gave us little teasers, which leaves a whole lot of speculation there. But at the same time, that's a whole lot of speculation there. So it's like, we don't really have anything to pinpoint to, but he did offer up certain books for certain characters. All-Star Superman is Superman, you know, the Authority is from a certain run. A couple of the movies are from, you know, inspired by all that. When we get to them, we'll talk about them. And the Authority, yeah, so the Authority will be a show, I believe.
Okay.
Because what was the movie?
They're running all this off through their Discovery HBO Max Connect? Like, where are they streaming this?
No, actually, Authority's going to be a movie. Sorry, I was wrong. I misspoke. Authority's going to be a movie, and yes, it'll be through HBO Max. HBO Max. I think the shows will be. The movies, I think, will be theatrical releases. Because they're going to do 2 a year.
Good.
Because they said this is chapter one of
Gods and Monsters.
What's called Gods and Monsters. Yeah, but it's only the first half of chapter one. This is a whole second. So that we're... talking about 20 things in one chapter, potentially.
Right, but I just like you announcing two movies. Like, we already got 5 coming and we still don't know what's going to happen. Like, let's just ease into this as opposed to another model where it's like, hey, we got 7 coming down the pipeline. Be ready.
Yeah. No, so Authority is a movie too, so it'll be Superman, Authority, and then 3 others. It'll be 5 movies, 5 shows like we're talking about. But anyways, the next show, which I believe is the last show, we call Paradise Lost.
Mm-hmm.
This is cool because it takes place in Themyscira.
Going back to Themyscira.
We don't know what year it takes place. We don't know if Diana's even going to be in it. But we do know it's going to be Game of Thrones-y.
Stylish.
Game of Thrones-y. There we go. Which is like,
Wouldn't it be all women?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Yeah.
Yeah. So... instead of all dudes.
Yeah, what do you I don't want no Greyjoy. I want some Mother of Dragon.
I was saying as in like, I'm intrigued. Like, what is going on? Like, how are you going to... So I guess, are they going to be politically charged, like different houses within Themyscira? Like different clans? I don't know how it works because I haven't seen a movie on just Themyscira before.
You meant not
Yeah, like, yeah. I meant more like Tim Toomans. Yeah, like, oh...
Yeah. Could be great. But again, I hope he's not writing this as well. I hope he's just poaching a whole bunch of
people. I don't think so. The only one he's been said to have written is he wrote Creature Commandos. That's done. That's ready to go.
Yeah, he's been writing that. Yeah.
So that's done. And he's writing Superman Legacy.
And I feel like Creature Commandos going to have like his darker sense of humor, like in Slither and stuff like that. And like all these like weird things that you're not expecting. So that one may be a treat that not everyone's really ready to handle, but...
Well, what's cool about stuff like Creature Commandos especially, and I guess a little bit of the Authority as well, is there's no real expectations because it's like, who are these people? I don't know. Introduce us to these people. There's no reboot. There's just all brand new, especially Creature Commandos because it's an animated show. It'd be crazy. It could be like Harley Quinn type thing, right? Yeah.
It would be like a Family Guy type of thing. You can go so many different ways with animation. Yeah. It's kind of amazing and lends to the kind of genius of what we think Gunn is setting up for the next few years of this side of
that's exciting.
Comic book
exciting.
World.
Now we'll get to the last 3 movies in a row. The next one, interesting title. I thought you'd like to hear about this, The Brave and the Bold. Really cool. So that's inspired off the Grant Morrison run,
which is called the, apparently like a great run. Like I haven't read it yet, but run. I'm pretty sure
I've read little bits of it. But yeah, it's well,
I'm sure we're getting into run. It, right?
And that run was based on the cartoon.
Ah, which I did like. Sort I really did like the Brave and Bold cartoon. The fact that we get in Damian finally as an iteration has taken a long time, but it's a two-prong effect. One, we get Damian, who's like just a psychopath in his own right and could probably murder Batman if he really needed to. Mm-hmm. But two, it kind of means that all the other Robins before him are on the map. And I think Gunn said this is the way that we're introducing the Bat family. So you
this is the
entrant point. So if you know Batman's got a son and he's playing Robin, like I'm sure Dick's out there. Like fingers crossed we get a Red Hood. Like I mean, Barbara's got to exist to some extent. This world is already established by the time Damian walks into it, and then flourishing by the time like Damian's like ruling it, and he's like. We even talk about Talia and Ra's. Like they exist now when Damian's such a linchpin for a funner side of Batman's stories because like nobody's clean, everybody's dirty, and like everybody's laundry's kind of out in the open. So again, it's easy to get excited about Batman, and it's also another Batman, but with so many writers and so many creators, it's always easy to do a Batman. So
yeah. It's you're right. It's another Batman, but it's a Batman at least we have never seen before. Like when was the last time he actually had a Robin with him?
Returns?
Batman.
Oh no, not even Forever. No.
Batman Forever, right?
Yeah. Oh, no.
He hasn't had one.
Ah, if you count Dark Knight Rises. And
no, I don't, because he was just like, "Oh, my name's Dick." Like it was like. No.
You know, like the logic of Bruce just leaving him the Batcave and then going off to Paris to go bang Catwoman?
Yeah, that was ridiculous. Like, yeah. And then be fine. And Alfred's just there. Nolan wanted out of that universe so bad. I'm done with this. I am done with this trilogy. God damn it.
Just gave up on logic. He's like, you know what? Something blew up and these guys left. Yeah.
My Bruce Wayne doesn't care.
It's over. Okay? That was done after the Joker. You guys wanted a trilogy. So, yeah, no, this is going to be fun. I think we're going to get capes, which is cool. I haven't seen, like, colorful capes and, like, bright costume. I think they're going to play into kind of the color scheme of Robin.
Do you think it'll be the blue Batman, though? Or the gray? I think it'll be gray. I don't think it's going to be pure black. I think it's going to be, like, the gray.
I'm not worried about the Batman. It's the Robin that I'm kind of interested in seeing.
You want the red and yellow with the green boots?
Yes, because he's such a psychopath that yeah. He'll make it badass, even though people will, like, poke him and prod him for, like, wearing tights. He's like, actually, I'm an assassin. Right?
Cynical. Yeah. Yeah, so he's kissed. Or, I'm just going to say it now. Best Robin. Damian's my favorite Robin.
Favorite Robin is different than best Robin.
Fair enough. The best Robin is probably Tim Drake, personally. But I think my favorite Robin is Damian.
No love to Dick. Jeez.
Dick's a better Nightwing. He's a better on his own.
Yes, he is. And that's what I was saying. This is probably we're getting this as a movie, correct?
Yeah.
Damian's gonna kill somebody.
He's gonna come close. You think he's actually gonna do it?
I think he's gonna kill somebody.
That'd be cool if he did. Because then Bruce is like, well, what do I do?
Yes, here? Yes.
Do I break my values or do I, you know?
Damian is the reason that you need a moral compass, but he has none. So there's so many, again, amazing linchpin. There's so many different directions. You gotta have baby mama drama. You're going to have father-in-law drama. You're going to have my girl. Who knows this? Who knows that? So even if they kept it streamlined to just Batman and Damian, that interaction of Batman having to be the level-headed one and he can't be kind of the dick. Like, Damian's more of an asshole than Batman is. And he's just his just desserts. Like, this is everything that you deserve being Batman for all these years.
Yeah. And I, like you said earlier, it brings us to the point where it's like, are Jason, Dick, and Tim out there?
I think so.
So do we have a Red Robin? Yes. Do we have a Red Hood? Do we have a Nightwing? Like, that's... Because you're skipping all ahead. That's sick. That's what I want. I want them to be out there.
And then just randomly show up. It's like, oh, you're here. It's like, yep. You didn't answer the call in time, right? Nightwing's on the job. Oh.
We just happen to have history. And if you want to cover it down the line, you can. But we don't need that. Just, I love it. Give us all the Robins. Yes. Come on. Give them all. Anyways, next up.
And Titans. that also another sorry linchpin that you can drop in very easily.
Yeah,
put them up.
Yeah, yeah. Good Paul. Let's get that Young Justice right. Ties to that. Next up is Booster Gold.
Right on. I never thought I'd see the day.
No, he's an internet darling. He is to the internet. I'm not saying this right. He's basically what Squirrel Girl is to the internet from Marvel's side. Everybody loves Squirrel Girl. Or not everybody, sorry. There's a cult following that loves Booster Gold. He doesn't do much for me, but it's kind of funny. This is going to be a very comedic film. It's going to be very silly.
Yep.
Because he's a loser from the future. It's far from the future. And he goes back in time to present time. And he becomes a hero using like basic technology from the future.
Which is amazing.
That we don't have yet.
It's like us going back in time with a lighter. And everyone's like, you're a god. And it's like, yes, I am. I'm here to rule you.
And that itself is pretty funny. So he's like this cocky kind of jerk. We'll see. We'll see how that goes. I think it'll be funny. This is probably the most comedic out of all of them.
Yes. And you said you don't like Booster Gold. And okay.
I didn't say that. I just said doesn't do much. I'm not part of that cult.
I love Booster Gold when he's teamed up. And you know who he's ultimately teamed up with?
Blue Beetle. So do you think they're going to use this Blue Beetle that's outside the DCU and bring him in? Because they said it's separate.
I just want them to understand it's okay if it's fractured. So if you have an incarnation of Blue Beetle who's a young man and you want this actor to keep going, fine. Don't feel like you have to rush or remove him. You can do a story over here in kind of a different pocket with another actor from another dimension just because you want this kind of camaraderie together. So I don't feel like you have to keep trying to build this intense net that everything is connected when you're already launching 5 movies that possibly won't even be connected to what's happening next. Just have fun and make sure the characters that you're moving forward with can shine the best way. And I always feel like Booster Gold shines when he has someone more capable next to him because he's kind of the fuck up on the team, right? Mm-hmm. I also said to you that I know Gunn had said previously after coming off of Guardians of the Galaxy 3 that he'll never do another Guardians of the Galaxy movie, especially with all these characters. But he loves these actors. So there's nothing to say that he won't poach somebody and bring them over to the DC. I think Chris Pratt would be kind of a hilarious Booster Gold on this side of it too.
He would be because he plays that like charming like dipshit really well. Like he basically is playing Star-Lord except way cockier, right?
Which is amazing, right? Like if you took all the breaks off of kind of Peter Quill and just let him be a complete dick, you get some Booster Gold love.
So I misspoke. Booster Gold will be a show, and then the next two will be movies, which is, I thought one was only one more, but there's two more. Supergirl, Woman of Tomorrow.
Awesome.
Which will be the first time Supergirl has hit the big screen since Superman 2?
I don't think she's in.
Superman 3.
She had her own.
She's in one.
She had her own movie. There's a Supergirl movie.
What was it?
From the 80s.
But was it a TV special, or was it?
No, it was like a release.
Okay. So anyways, this will be the first time she gets one in how long then? Like 30 years?
She has kind of a successful TV show going on now, but I think it's another CW.
They're ending all those, right? Yeah. So this one is all about, this was cool. You know how when Krypton blew up?
Right. Oh, yeah.
And Kal-El ends up in Earth. Well, Kara survives on a piece of Krypton.
Hmm.
And it's all about her, how she becomes much more jaded than Kal-El did because he grew up, he fell amongst a family and they raise him. She just survives on her own on this one chunk of Krypton that's kind of floating through space.
Huh.
So it's all about, so that's really cool. That's a Tom King album, Tom King written story that I haven't read, but is lauded. There's a lot of people that say this is dope. And they're adapting, so they're not adapting it, but they're, like I said, they're using that as like the tonal reference for this show or movie.
Because if she's not starting on Earth, like the possibilities are endless of who she may come in contact to on her way to Earth, which is kind of cool. But the fact that she's already going to be kind of a 180 to what Kal-El is, and they potentially will have a face-off of a fisticuffs is super cool. Supergirl, the last time she was in the theaters was 1984. by Helen Slater playing Kara. So she's overdue. And this story could be maybe the best one they got going.
And she's a good character. Do you remember, was it Superman, Batman, Apocalypse where she was in it and they fought? She ends up living with Kal-El for a while and Doomsday, or not Doomsday, Darkseid's there and stuff. And that was a great movie. Like, that's a good, she was more like carefree there, but she was learning Earth, right? Which is
cool. We read Crisis on Earth and she's kind of, she sacrifices herself to save Kal-El, right? She understands that's the family dynamic. She loves her cousin. This is the only family she has left. So that's going to be an amazing dynamic when they just figure out we're the last two. And hopefully it doesn't go dark into like kissing cousins or anything like that. But rule.
Did he land in Alabama?
Rule 34.
And finally, number 10. This will be a movie. I am pumped for Swamp Thing.
No time.
Ooh, baby. First time we've seen him since those Wes Craven movies, or we reviewed one of
those are amazing, first of all.
Yeah, the first one was hilarious, the grenades. So, and the
suit.
The second one we haven't done yet, but
we will do it.
We probably should.
Got me on the TV show. The TV show was great. They just ran out of money, I guess, and kind of folded. We've read several iterations of it. We've seen him on how many different movies. He's such a gem. He should be kind of a top-tier Justice League member, if not Dark Justice League.
Yeah,
and essentially he could open up the Dark Justice League. You could see Zatanna through him. You could see Constantine through him. You can see Etrigan through him. Deadman. There's so many. A darker Batman. Swamp Thing kind of holds a lot in his hands.
And because he's connected to basically all of Earth, he can go anywhere. So you want him to meet, he can introduce anybody. The cool thing about this one is that James Gunn made a point of saying this is the one movie that will not fit the rest tonally. This is going to be horror themed.
Which is amazing.
It's going to be based off Alan Moore's run, which is the seminal Swamp Thing run. And we talked about it a lot in our Alan Moore episode. And I'm pumped, man. I'm pumped. Something is always getting the short end of the stick. Even he's been getting chances, which is because there was a cartoon. And
he is the stick.
Like I said, old Wes Craven. Yeah, he's the stick. So we just keep seeing the raw end. Right. But this I could not be more excited for. Like I said at the top, we have no details except for the fact that it's based off the or will be the spiritual, tonally. It's going to be based off the Alan Moore run. It's going to be used as inspiration. And like we were saying at the top, you're getting what you want or what you've been asking for, which is fractured universe.
Yeah.
Okay. Those old Batman, because you've always been saying, just make freaking five different Batman movies.
I'll watch them. They'll all make money.
Like you said, so you're getting your wish. And I've always been bitching about
Swamp Thing.
Well, yes, but I was like, get weird.
Yes.
Get weird. Yeah. Go in. Ignore the Trinity. They're not quite ignoring the Trinity here. They're still all here if Diana's assumed to be in Paradise Lost. But they're getting really weird.
Yeah.
Creature Commandos. What is that? Authorities? I don't know. Mr. Gold, Swamp Thing. They're getting weird and I love it.
To piggyback off Creature Commandos, I would expect to see one of them, possibly two of them, in Swamp Thing. I know James Gunn is on the record of saying the actors that are voicing the characters for these roles will also be the live action versions of them. And he looks forward to kind of swinging the door back and forth between animated and live action. And that, I don't know if that's been done yet. I haven't seen Bradley Cooper walking around in a Rocket Raccoon suit. So it's cool. It's cool that Gunn has already established that whoever I'm picking for this, you may see as a cartoon, but you're also going to see them when I'm ready to bring them into a live action role in wherever they slot into this universe.
Yeah, they're following the Marvel blueprint, but they're getting ahead of themselves in this time. Because I know in a lot of the animated Marvel stuff, like the What Ifs and stuff, they got, I think, most of the cast to do their voice lines. But now they've kind of priced themselves out.
Yes.
So it's
got into legal battles as it was happening.
Right. So James Gunn is getting ahead of that. It's like, listen, if you're signing up for us, you kind of have to do everything that we do, which is
and reversing this is it where too, I, right? Reversing it in terms of you get the animation yes. first, so you can kind of get a feel of what you think the live action is going to be, but you have no idea, right? Animation can give you kind of an idea, but you never know how a suit's going to fit. You never know how like a mask is going to look. You never know how gorgeous Zoe Saldana is going to be in another shade.
Lovely, lovely.
Again, so that's another one that I hope he poaches from the Guardians.
Callahan. I don't know. She's kind of sick of these. I think she's a little bit sick of the
depends the role
interconnected things. It depends on the role, but you were saying that from the animation to the live action, which is true because we've seen Viola Davis a few times as Amanda Waller, but it's going to happen with her here because she's going to be in Creature Commandos first as an animated Waller, and then she gets her own show, which is live action. Right. It's going to be the same character.
Yes.
Everything's connected. When he talked about everything being connected, he did make sure to say movies, shows, animation, and this is what I got concerned with is video games. Mm. And I'm like, what? Huh. You don't need that. You really don't need that. So it almost complicates things too much. It kind of restricts them because there are in video games or in the world of video games, there are movie tie-ins,
right.
which are basically adaptations of the movie into a game. And those are almost never good because they have to change things up to make a video right. game, right? But with like the most recent Spider-Man, for example, from 2018, and then again in Miles Morales 2 years later in 2020, those are just self-contained things. They used a whole different Spider-Man. They used a whole different universe. And I think that worked for the better. So I'm a little concerned if they're going to tie in too many video games. But then at the same time, if they're doing Elseworld stuff, then I guess they'll be Elseworld games.
And, that's right? what I would argue for the other side. I think this is his way to be like, okay, if we're going to do a Batman game, I'm going to use the Robins that you haven't seen on the movie or the TV show. They're in this world, you know, they're Gotham, but they're just occupying this space over here. So it's a very easy way to intro another character and have them run a whole entire story that's not connected specifically with the main one that you know from the TV animation or movie, but it's still in the same world. So I think he's smart enough to know that we can do a lot in the same space. Like, look, if there's a Lantern video game, you have an entire universe, right? Like, let's say you play as Guy Gardner and just go around getting bitch slapped by everybody. I mean, that's a fun game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's what I mean. That's the only thing I was a little concerned about. I was like, I kind of want you to keep video games in their own, but we'll see how it goes.
Wait, does that mean we're not getting King Shark anymore? From like, we just got the Harley Quinn King Shark because it was Samoa Joe. The last previous DC.
No, game? We'll get. The game. Yeah, this one, Kill the Justice League.
Yeah, is that off the books?
It hasn't come out yet. Okay. It hasn't come out yet, but it's going to be developed independently from this.
Okay.
So it won't be this. It won't be Sylvester Stallone doing the voice of King Shark. I don't think. Well, because Kevin Conroy is actually the voice. It's the last thing.
Wow.
He's the voice in that game. Wow. The last thing is Batman.
R.I.P. Still, man. Like the voice of our childhood and now a generation.
It's our Batman.
Hopefully gets the nod. I'm still hoping that somehow Flashpoint has a cameo with him in it too.
That'd be dope. He did play it in the show. Oh, no. He played live action Batman, like older Batman. Yeah. And he was just like, have you ever listened to him on podcasts and stuff?
No,
interviews? He's so full. He loves being Batman. He just loves
it. Why wouldn't you?
And now they're saying like, which is kind of sad. Mark Hamill doesn't really want to do the Joker anymore because he's like, I only wanted to do it with him. Like, I don't want to do it. It's not the same.
It's a perfect match.
Anyways.
You can go back to drinking green titty milk.
That's right. The alien alien tits. What are you most excited for in this? Because I'm obviously Swamp Thing. I'm huge on Swamp Thing. But this is just one that you could pick out, and Lanterns. But if there's one thing you could pick out, or two things you could pick out, it's like that's my ish.
Waller.
That's gonna be dope. I think it's gonna be really dope. That's a good call.
We have the Suicide Squad, what she's done. I've watched Peacemaker and I enjoy it. But we have kind of an understanding of what that's gonna be. There's not a lot of surprises, and if there are surprises, I kind of already trust what's already in place, that I'm in safe hands. But if I didn't know that show was coming, I would, again, I'm looking more at shows than I am at movies.
Movies?
I think the movies will be fine. Like, again, even, and I'm still excited for Flashpoint. Like, we still talk about like how much shit show that is, but goddamn, like it's definitely going to break a whole bunch of things. That Lantern show with the two things that he said was basically we got Hal Jordan, we got John Stewart, and it's going to be more detectives and like crime and space. It's like, ooh.
That's hard. That's hard not to be like amped for. And to me, anyway, that's hard not to be like, yo, that's going to be sick.
Because that's possibly where I get my wish list of Martian Manhunter.
Oh, yeah, I haven't thought of him this whole time. I haven't even thought of him. That's a good point. Because he's got to pop up somewhere,
it's,
right?
And that's the whole thing. I think we pitched that at one point that they were trying to get Green Lantern on. It's like, we should just do a Green Lantern and Martian Manhunter film where there's a battle on Mars and these lanterns got to come break it up. And eventually you get John Jones facing off with Red Lantern. But there's so much going on in space. It's been underutilized by DC. Considering your crown jewel is an alien.
Yeah.
The lanterns have been untouched for, I'm just going to keep referencing 15 years, although that's probably not true. It's probably 30 years at this point. My imagination goes bonkers with that.
So one last question. We did this way back in episode 5. We talked about the villains of Marvel and who we wanted to see in the MCU. Remember where we had a wish list, and I think our wish list pretty much came true, didn't it? Just about. I got my gore. Yeah. Didn't really work out as well as I planned.
I'm still missing one, yeah. But I'm good.
Yeah, I asked for Proteus. I haven't got Proteus yet.
Okay.
I can't remember who you
I
asked
got for,
for
Juggernaut. I was happy about that. We should have re-listened to that.
Doom.
I haven't got Doom yet. I'm still waiting for Doom.
I just brought this back, but I remember getting gore and still waiting for Proteus. But anyways, on the DC side of things,
yeah.
Who do you want to see?
So we're doing a little draft here?
We do a little draft. I put a whole bunch of extras just in case you started taking them. I got a killer in here, but go ahead.
I have a killer in here. I wonder if you have the same killer. So I'm listing this, anticipating that I'm going to get it in Flashpoint, but I still want guns hands on it. And that's Professor Zoom, the Reverse Flash, Anti-Flash, Anti-Matter. If you're going to remove Ezra Miller, is that his name? Ezra Miller, yeah. From Flash, that's great. But if you leave a Flash kind of on the universe that it inevitably like relaunches another hero to rise, I think that would be an amazing way to handle the Flash property. But like Professor Zoom in his bright yellow undies is kind of a maniac and a psychopath, and under Gunn's hands I think would be so much fun.
There was this tweet I saw that it was kind of, what was it? They had six antagonists from comics. Okay. And they said, if you can take out one of them, who would it be? Like, just erase from comic history. And it was Dr. Doom, Lex Luthor, Magneto, two other guys. The Reverse Flash was in there, and then two other guys. And I can't remember who they were now. But it was all really good villains. Right. And then, like, to me, Reverse Flash kind of stuck out. So I was reading the comments, and people were like, Reverse Flash is he should be the one you get rid of, because he's just like this offshoot villain that just won't go away like a shit stain. Like, he just will not leave you alone. And that's what makes him so beautiful, is that he's so obsessed with just killing the Flash. Yes. He doesn't care about anything else.
He's obsessed.
Whereas, like, because they're comparing him to the Joker, because the Joker was in there too. It's like, no, Joker just likes anarchy.
Right.
And he's like in love with Batman.
It doesn't care who he's battling.
Yeah, the Reverse Flash just hates Flash so much. It's like, he just hates him so much.
He wants
much
to be faster than him. He wants to be better than him. He wants him out. And so again, like, this could be the setup of like, oh, I killed him. Yeah. It's like, did you kill the real Flash? Or did you kill this version of the Flash? Right. So, I love his obsession.
It was just a funny little, project or study.
Quirk.
With six. I can't remember the fifth one, but it was Dr. Doom, Lex Luthor, Magneto, Joker, Reverse Flash, and somebody else. And they were all like legit villains, except I was like, not him. But then I read the comments and like people were championing for him because they knew he was like the weak link. And it was funny.
You cheer for him. Maybe Brainiac was the fifth guy? Superman?
No, but he may have been actually. He may have been. Because he was actually going to be one of my picks here, Brainiac.
I did not pick him because I thought he was going to come. I just assumed he'd be
there. He hasn't come yet, but that I think he's going to show up in...
I looked at this list of choosing our top five, not so much as what I wanted to see, but what I want Gunn to take a hold of and what I assume he's already doing. So I didn't do Lex Luthor. There's already only Jokers. I went a little deeper in the kind of the bag.
So did I kind of had a mixture. I had a mixture. So I did put Brainiac, for the simple fact that we have never seen him in live.
That's action. True, and it would be amazing to kind of see how they handle him.
Yeah, exactly, because it's interesting. Sometimes I don't like him, and other times I do. Mm-hmm. And it's, again, I think it has to do with the writer. If he's just like an android that's just taking things, it doesn't, but when you kind of get him to talk a bit, and he speaks about how he's so, he's a machine, but he's just so cold mm-hmm. that it's almost funny. It's like he does not care about anything. He'll just shrink a city down and take it, and that's all there is to
and logical. Like, there's certain times where you believe what he's saying because, like, this makes perfect sense. I've crunched all the numbers. Like, this is the way that we need to move forward. That's why he's one of the best kind of characters in Red Sun, because he finds ways to, like, honey-dick Superman into, like...
That's right.
Into, like, going up against the United States. It's like, well, you tricked me. It's like, yes, you're an idiot. Like, this is what you need to do to take over being a Russian power. He's amazing.
So, yeah, that was my one. Who else you got?
Okay. I would have said Vandal Savage, but I thought he's going to find a way in somehow. I'd love to see him in Authority. We should maybe say where you want to, like, slot them in. But, yeah, go for it.
Yeah, stop there for a second. Stop there for a second. Because I didn't put Vandal Savage because I thought you would.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, he's going to put... So I did.
I did, but I instantly cut it because I was like, what do I want to see James Gunn do? And who would I want to see him do it with? So I put Granny Goodness. And I thought she would be amazing in the hands of James Gunn. And she could kind of go anywhere. Like, I'd love to see her in Waller. I'd love to see her in The Authority. If she's like, I mean, and she can pop up just because she's so unassuming, but like, what a crazy cool character.
Yeah. And she's almost a precursor for Darkseid, who will be in it at some point. So she's almost like the harbinger of, like,
yes.
Okay. So Darkseid exists because she works for him, but you don't have to see him for literally like 10 years.
And true fans would be like, I know who that is. Yeah. So I think, and she'd end up being like sarcastic and gross and amazing.
Where did you want to see your first villain?
Professor Zoom? I want to see him in the kind of...
Well, Flash, obviously. Yeah. Brainiac, obviously, in a Superman movie. Right. That's kind of the foil. That's how he gets introduced. Granny Goodness, where do you see her?
I was going to say Waller, because I just want to see women fight off each other. But I'd love to see her in something weird like The Authority, because I don't know what it's going to be. So you can kind of slot anybody in there.
So I also had Gorilla Grodd. We've seen him in Flash the Show, and he was back when I used to watch it. He was in it for 2 episodes, and he was fantastic. And we haven't seen him in live action.
Right.
Now, the easy thing to do here is to put him in with the Flash movie. I don't want that. I don't want that. I want him in Creature Commandos. That's what I want.
Right.
They stumble upon the city of gorillas. And it's like, what? And now he's established, and he's there, and he can pop up anywhere. Right. And that's kind of my thing. I'd also like to see him Paradise Lost.
That'd be cool.
Crazy if all of a sudden he's just like a bunch of gorillas are there. Right? It doesn't have to make sense. I don't care. I know he's a Flash villain, but, you know, like, yeah, that'd be sick.
It's like, we've been here the whole time in the jungle. You just didn't go this deep. Ultra, that'd be so cool, man.
Yeah, it's ultra smart gorillas against the Amazon.
He's going to be wearing the weird...
We're going full tilt. I want that big, stupid hat on his head.
Gorilla Grodd's in my second tier. I was just like, if Coke says this, then I know I can pull this up. But
yeah,
good call. I like the Grodd. We're on third.
Yeah.
I went Magic because I know how much you love Magic. I went with Morgan Le Fay.
Okay.
And I went that because I'm putting in Swamp Thing, but I just think she's amazing to launch the Dark DC universe. Like, to open up the Dark Justice League, to bring in Zatanna or Zartan or Etrigan. Again, we said that Constantine. Like, you need a foil, and she's kind of the best.
You know what's interesting? Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off, but I almost put Merlin in mind. Because he's recently become a big foil in DC Comics. And I was like, so Morgan Le Fay...
Yeah.
Plus Merlin. We're talking because I was thinking Magic too. Yeah. I was on the same page. Yeah. Go ahead, use it.
Well, I said everything I want to say. I think she's just perfect, right? And again, in the hands of James Gunn, I think the casting would be great. I just think she would be a lead and kind of command the presence of the screen. And I like villains who you want to look at and they're just going to chew you up and spit you out, not even think twice about it. So bring me that magic. Bring me that dark magic.
I said I had a killer on this list. I have two killers on this list, I just realized. But one of them is near and dear to my heart, and I'm gonna say it right now, Larfleeze.
Nice.
Larfleeze, which is awesome because obviously I want him in the Lanterns show at some point. And what I love about Larfleeze is that he's the sole member of the Orange Lantern Corps because he's so bloody selfish and greedy, he won't share rings with anybody else. He just wants it all to himself. And I think that's hilarious. And he's just like,
"Yep,
no, it's mine. Yep. This is mine. I'm greedy. You're not going to have it." So you don't even have to have him as an Orange Lantern yet. But if you establish that he exists,
yes,
and kind of his, how much of a dick he is, it's like, okay, that's...
I'm just hungry, man. I just want to eat.
Just hungry. And then so that way when he does, he gets powered up. Because you can put Atrocious in there too, but or Atros, but like Larfleeze is like, he's funny and dangerous. And I love that combination.
It's a good call. My last three ended up being Batman villains just because he's got the best rogue gallery. And I know it's
coming.
Do you?
Yeah, I think so.
Go well, ahead. This one, I'm instantly slotting him into, Creature Commandos because I want to see him animated, but to see this character live action, Born on a Monday, Solomon Grundy, come on,
Born on a Monday,
like there's not a lot going on with him, but he's always a force, like he's always somebody's best heavy or muscle, like he's always a sub boss. He's never the main guy, and I'm fine with, but he's so interesting, and he's, for lack of a better word, charismatic because you're drawn to like what he is. He's the thing, like he's DC's thing in my eyes. I just love to see him like realized and conceptually put together, animated as well as live action, because this, he's a beast of a man, if you can even call him a man, right? So just see him like three times the size of a Batman character would be insane.
What's interesting about him too is that he's like, he's not really a villain, but he doesn't care. Like he'll do his own thing. But he gets roped and stuff. He's like, I'll fight Batman.
Yeah, he's kind of a merc.
I'm born in the morning.
Yeah, he's kind of a merc. He's a little bit Deathstroke. Yeah. He's a little bit Deadpool in terms of like, I don't care. Like if the price is right, I'm gonna do it. But he's barely motivated by money. It's kind of like, what's happening now? All right, cool. This is what's going on. Mm-hmm. I'm in for it. So you could
I'm interested.
You could easily turn him into a hero. He could easily become a Suicide Squad member. He could, I mean, if you want to make him a foil for Superman, I think he could be slotted in so many different places. I just want to see him. Like, show me what your Grundy looks like.
It's interesting you brought up Batman villains or people that are kind of connected to the Batman universe, because my fourth one, Lady Shiva.
Oh shit!
Will be dope for Brave and the Bold because League of Assassins connections, right? That. So you were talking about Raj and Talia earlier. What about Lady Shiva?
What about Lady Shiva?
What about her? Right? If you can do different histories too. Did she train with Batman growing up? Like, did they come from the same spot? Did she train with like just the pure League of Assassins? Is she a mercenary on her own? I don't know, but she's a formidable fighter. And she's smart, so I think that'd be dope.
Leave it to Coke to find a way to bring it back to the dragons. You gotta love the samurais, or not even just the martial artists, right? The way of the fist. This is my toss-up, because I could take it or leave it. And honestly, I think you could slot him in anywhere, because I really love the story of the man. But he hasn't been done well when he was
done. I hope you say
done. But again, like I need Mr. Freeze. I want to see a Mr. Freeze. I need an ice cold. I need such a threat globally that it brings in more than one hero to come save the day. I don't necessarily think he has to be in Brave and the Bold. I think he's smart enough and powerful enough and could like connect with a whole bunch of people. Like, there's how many snow people in like the DC roster, right?
Captain Cold.
And they're not great, but you know who's running the ship, and it's Victor. It's Victor Freeze. I just always appreciated his backstory and like his motivations. Like, yo, I'm just trying to save my girl. If you get in the way of that, you're done.
Iced.
So yeah, I'd love to see a better iteration than what we've gotten.
I was gonna say, can you believe we've seen him once and it was like a joke?
It was you, Arnold Schwarzenegger. Like, what?
Yeah.
That doesn't even make sense. Yeah. But
like Riddler's got his comeuppance, and it wasn't even like Jim Carrey wasn't even that bad of Riddler. It was kind of a Riddler Joker blend or something. But Riddler's got his comeuppance with the Batman, so we got a more formidable Riddler now. I agree. It's time for Mr. Freeze. Let's bring in some Mr. Freeze. My last one. What's fifth? I've got a whole bunch written down, but
I want a six man because I have a six man, and I'm hoping six man's gonna hopefully blow you off.
Okay,
blow you out the seat.
Damn, man. Oh, it's a girl. Yeah. I'm gonna rock your world right now.
I like that you figured that out too.
Yeah.
Good idea.
I'm gonna rock your world. Number five, take a drink. Condiment King. I want to see the Condiment King in this DCU. You know James Gunn's dying to do it. You know he's dying to do it.
I just blew myself. Oh my
god. I waited till you were taking a drink to say that. You know he's thinking. He's thought about it.
He's gonna do good. He would do good.
You know he's thought about it. There's no way because you can put him Creature Commandos, I guess. Brave and the Bold, sure. Booster Gold.
Oh, why not?
There's a good one, right? Maybe Booster Gold's first fight is against the Condiment King. Gets sprayed up with all this
ketchup, mustard.
Ketchup and mustard. Just a throwaway guy. He doesn't have to be a whole arc. Just a throwaway guy.
And we've gotten Condiment King in the what you don't count as a true Batman movie, but I do, the Lego Batman movie, and it was.
That's right. Yeah, that's right.
His two squirts were hilarious. I enjoyed that.
I mean, if James Gunn can make us care for Polka Dot Man,
yeah,
what makes you think he can't make us care about Condiment King?
I mean, we already care about Condiment King.
Yeah, we care. That'd be amazing. Amazing.
You're blowing my mind now because I'm not going to say the one that we should have said because we've been championing for that anyway, but we'll do that at the end because we're both from this. That's our same pick. We're both going to get him in this universe.
I feel like we're talking about the same person. Yeah.
Yes, so. But that's not this pick. This pick is my Sixth Man of the Year and arguably my favorite Batman movie. Villain was so good and kind of blew my socks off of what you could do with it. I would love to see Phantasm.
Oh, I didn't see that coming.
And with the Brave and the Bold, just that dynamic and true fans of that story know how much it really just put Bruce on kind of his ass. And of recent time, they tried to create these characters that are closely knit to Bruce, right? You get the Hush characters, even to an extent you get the Harvey Dents. And yeah, but like Phantasm was so left field and not what you were expecting and ended up like almost doing them in. To throw that into the world that Batman's already living with Damian, I think would be insane.
The only issue is that it's kind of like a Hush thing where it's like you already know who it is, so it's kind of the surprise is gone. But I think you're right. I think they could make an incredible story out of that anyways. Just doesn't matter.
I'd love them. I mean, again, we keep knocking on Marvel's door, but we've done a lot of Marvel properties. I'd love them to kind of set up a Batman world where he's living it like Clint Barton and he has these ladies in his life that he can't keep happy because he's got Talia, he's got Selina, and potentially he's got Phantasm. Like, just keep giving him women that he can't juggle because the walls are closing in.
Yeah. Okay, I have four more names here. We don't have to go through all of them, but for my sixth man, I'm going to leave the one off that I think we have the same.
Yeah.
Because I think there's one that we kind of understand needs a redemption. And, maybe not.
Oh,
maybe
so not you're that. Thinking different.
Maybe not that.
You know who we want.
Yeah. But I'm going to say something just like right left. I'm going to take, because I've been taking kind of just regular guys. Sure. I'm going to take a superpower. I'm going to take Despero.
Huh.
And he's a threat not quite as big as Darkseid, but he's up there.
Yeah,
he's got that mind-controlling third eye that will like... He's a Justice League level threat, and I would want to see him in Supergirl, Woman of Tomorrow.
Right.
She's up in space. She's doing her thing. She comes across Despero. They get into a tilt. She gets smoked, but it's like, okay, so now you know this threat is out there that can handle a Krypton, right? So it's like, okay, you know, I got saved there, but he comes, and then he'll come back around maybe when the Justice League, not even the full Justice League, but a few of them start teaming up again. Now you know he's out there. You should establish him. That's a world level threat, right? So you don't. There's almost a stepping stone or a sub boss to Darkseid without it being tied to Darkseid.
Right.
So it's a different villain, right? So it's not part of Darkseid's team. It's something else. That would be my sixth man.
Right on. Those are strong lists. I think we can get at least half of those. And who's to say what's happening tomorrow, right? We keep looking at this new roster, but he's already talked about this is just chapter one, Gods and Monsters. So I don't even know what chapter two is going to look like, but he can go so many different ways in so many different areas that it's hard not to get excited about it. But again, we run a podcast where we get excited about these things. So.
Yeah, we just talked for over an hour about nothing. Yeah. With something we know nothing about. Words. Just our hopes and dreams. Who else did you have left on your list? Because I have three names left.
So I'll give you three. The best of my three, I listed Trigon because I went monsters and I was like, he'd be a great way world builder.
Sick.
To get up to level, and you can pull in how many characters that you want to do with it.
So that'd be connected to Raven.
If you want to. And then again, that's another nod to Damien and that lifestyle and that path you could take. I listed Sportsmaster because I think Gunn would make him like more like a Deathstroke kind of on Deadpool.
Yeah.
Tongue in cheek.
See, we're thinking of like Gunn type villains, right? Like Conan McKay. I was like, yo, he's got to have Conan McKay.
Who you had fun with. And then a toss up between two, but I'm going to go with Owlman because I just think.
Mm-hmm. Going different dimensions.
It's just smart because you don't have to put him in the Batman series. You could literally put him anywhere else. And if that's, let's say you throw him in Paradise Lost and it happens to be Wonder Woman that's in that. If this is her first meeting of what she thinks a Batman is, then when she inevitably meets Batman, it's not going to go over well either. So I kind of like that this is another kind of a Professor Zoom sort of mirror image. Yeah. I know how much you love when heroes face themselves, but.
I guess it's my favorite trope.
DC kind of perfectionist of it. Like, it's the thing that they do.
Yeah, the multiverse and stuff.
And again,
they did it before Marvel did.
What you were saying is, it's not necessarily the character, it's the writer. So I think someone could really write a smart Owlman.
Would you bring back James Woods?
that's another careful, colorful celebrity.
Yeah.
Sure. Isn't he like 60 something?
Yeah, I'm just kidding. He's not going to be playing Owlman.
I mean, if it's Owlman just sitting the whole time, cool, and like pushing a button.
It's too bad. He's got a great voice for that.
It's so good.
Real snarky. So I had three more. Mongol was up there as another kind of Despero level threat. He's kind of like a little bit below, but you know, when you go back to that classic Whatever Happened to the Man of Tomorrow storyline. Right. He's behind it all. So I think he's a good villain and we've never seen him on the big screen. I also had the Ultra Humanite, which, by the way, is the first ever DC villain. He fought Superman in the first issue in like the 1940s. And he was a mad scientist who turned himself into like this gorilla Yeti looking thing, right? Yeah. And he's kind of throwaway, but that would be a really cool nod to the heritage and the history of DC Comics, especially if he was in Superman Legacy.
Right.
You know, he's not an alien. He's a mad scientist who turns himself into a creature. You can kill him off in the movie. It doesn't matter. But it would be a cool nod, in my opinion, to how it would be. The third person who I thought we would be in the same streamline with would be a full redemption of Two-Face.
Yeah. I'm surprised no one had said it to this point, but I figured.
Yeah. Because I thought he'd be on your list, but he was like number three on mine. I just skipped over him because I was like, we'll talk about him in the end because we got to get a Two-Face movie, a proper Two-Face movie. Aaron Eckhart was good. It's just he was robbed with screen time.
I think. And he should have got his own movie. Like that should have been the third. Third movie should have been him and Bane should have been. And Bane was on my list too of like side characters because I want Bane in all of his glory, not really like a grounded version. I want someone that's souped up Venom.
Actually smart. Yeah.
And like taking drugs and not Uma Thurman drugs with painted on.
That's right. That's the only. You know why I get confused? Because he's been in. I feel like he's been in the anime movies so many times.
And done.
That he's been.
And done well in the anime.
That he's like good. But then I forget that his only live action thing is that nonsense with Uma Thurman.
Batman and Robin. And then kind of.
Oh, and then
Dark Knight Rises.
Rises.
I like what's his face? What's Venom's name? I like Tom Hardy, but that's not a Tom Hardy role.
No.
Superman. Well, Batman.
I don't know.
It turned into a character real fast. It's interesting the people that we didn't name, but I think they're coming regardless, right? Like we didn't say Lex, we didn't say Scarecrow, we didn't say Deathstroke, we didn't say Darkseid. But people need to know who we want, and we will always want Egghead. We want Egghead.
Nobody cares.
Nobody cares.